incarceration on social media, on television, and you may even be familiar with a term that had currency, that has had currency for quite some time in abolitionist circles, decarceration, right? You may even be familiar with the notion of prison abolition. Are you? Well, let me quote from a New York Times editorial last May 24th, 2014. And of course, this was not last May, but May before last. And this was before Ferguson, of course, and before the Black Lives Matter movement developed. So this is the New York Times. The insanity of the situation of mass incarceration is plain to people across the political spectrum. From Attorney General Eric Holder Jr. to former House Speaker Newt Gingrich, who agree on the urgent need for change. The research is in, and it is uncontestable. It is the American experiment. The American experiment in mass incarceration has been a moral, legal, social, and economic disaster. It cannot end soon enough. This is the New York Times. Ta-Nehisi Coates, who is the author of Between the World and Me, which some of you may have read, and he's the recent recipient of the MacArthur Award, so-called Genius Award. He is the author of an article entitled The Black Family in the Age of Mass Incarceration that appeared in a very recent issue of The Atlantic Monthly. And he concludes with this observation. Indeed, the experience of mass incarceration, the warehousing and deprivation of whole swaths of our country, the transformation of that deprivation into wealth transmitted through government jobs and private investment, the pursuit of the war on drugs on nakedly racist grounds, have only intensified the ancient American dilemma's white hot core, the problem of, quote, past unequal treatment, unquote, the difficulty of damages, which is what he calls the question of reparations. Now, Ta-Nehisi Coates is seriously attentive to history and does not assume that this problem can be immediately fixable. On the contrary, as he recognized, we have finally, and this is a good thing, opened Pandora's box of historical racism. And in order to attend to them, as Coates points out, we will have to address the always urgent case for reparations. And some of you may be familiar with his article, The Case for Reparations. What is needed, he writes, is an airing of family secrets, a settling with old ghosts. What is needed is a healing of the American psyche and the banishment of the banishment of white guilt. He says, what I'm talking about is more than recompense for past injustices, more than a handout, a payoff, hush money, or a reluctant drug. What I'm talking about is a national reckoning that would lead to spiritual renewal. Reparations would mean the end of scarfing hot dogs on the 4th of July while denying the facts of our heritage. Reparations would mean the end of young patriotism while waving a Confederate flag. Reparations would mean a revolution of the American consciousness, a reconciling of our self-image as the great democratizer with the facts of our history. Now, recently, President Obama dramatically broke his long silence on the prison crisis. By, first of all, speaking on the issue at the most recent NAACP conference, and then by becoming the first sitting president to visit a prison. I think Obama is really reflecting on his legacy now. And he thereby became a central figure in a new HBO documentary, Vice documentary, that was entitled Fixing the System, to which I will refer a little later in my talk. But first, let me say something about Obama's speech before the National Conference of the NAACP this summer. And incidentally, Obama was followed by Bill Clinton. So, you know, Obama, it's interesting because his talk made me think about talks that I heard and discussions and talks that I myself gave in, say, the early 90s through the late 90s when we founded critical resistance. He says, the United States is home to 5% of the world's population, but 25% of the world's prisons. We've been saying that for years and years and years. Our incarceration rate is 4 times higher than China's. He goes on and on. And he says, but this is interesting now. He says, every year we spend $80 billion to keep folks incarcerated. For $80 billion, we can have universal preschool for every 3-year-old and 4-year-old in America. That's what $80 billion buys. For $80 billion, we could double the salary of every high school teacher in America. For $80 billion, we could finance new roads, bridges, airports, job training programs, research and development, et cetera, et cetera. And he says, for what we spend to keep everyone locked up for 1 year, we could eliminate tuition at every single one of our public colleges and universities. How much is tuition here at King State? And you know, it's statements like this that make us recognize how deeply implicated we are ourselves in these processes, because we assume that tuition is a necessary thing. And we have not reached the point where we can openly call for free public education. And that is what public education was supposed to be in the very beginning. I mean, that is supposed to be the definition of public education as opposed to private education. Now, Obama went on to applaud the fact that Republicans and Democrats alike are coming together around this issue. I doubt very seriously whether the Republicans would be in favor of abolishing tuition and public colleges and universities. But in any event, Bill Clinton, I mentioned that he spoke after Obama, and he acknowledged his at least partial responsibility for the soaring prison population, which was in part a consequence of the changes that were brought about by the 1994 Violent Crime Control and Law Enforcement Act. Clinton admitted that he made the issue of mass incarceration worse with this act. If we were to talk about the act, we'd also point out that the Violence Against Women Act is embedded within this larger uniform crime, violent crime and law enforcement act, which is somewhat problematic. Because then we would have to say that strategies addressing gender violence have also led to the soaring prison population. As Beth Ritchie argues in her very important book, which is called Arrested Justice, Black Women, Violence, and the Prison Nation. And what is different, of course, and Obama was referring to this, is that the right wing has now taken up the call for an end to mass incarceration. So why do you think that's happening? Do you find that bizarre? Well, yeah, it's about money. You're absolutely right. And I have to say that I'm really not that excited about people like Rand Paul and Newt Gingrich joining the ranks of those who are calling for an end to mass incarceration. I watched the recent Republican debate, well, I promise not to mention the name of the candidate whose initials are DT, because I understand that we may be speaking simultaneously. Exactly, exactly. But we'll mention Rand Paul, who called for, during those debates, during that debate, criminal justice reform, and he referenced so many of the injustices that have come about as a result of a so-called war on drugs. Now, it's very interesting that the documentary I spoke about earlier, the Vice documentary, which premiered on HBO a few days ago, is entitled Fixing the System. As far as documentaries about the prison crisis is concerned, it's a good introduction to some of the issues. How many of you saw it? Well, it's, you know, it's worth watching. What I found most moving about it was the conversations Obama had with a number of the prisoners. There was one young man whose name was Bobby Reed, who received a life sentence for conspiracy to distribute cocaine.
Oh.
And he said, good people make bad decisions, but you should not be punished for life. And then there's a shot of his brother. They interviewed the families of the men who were involved in the circle with Obama. And his brother said, the system is backwards. It hurts. And then he pointed out that his brother didn't smoke or drink or do drugs, and now he's doing a life sentence. There was a very interesting interview with Eric Holder, who evoked the names of so many of the people who have been killed by the police recently. LeVar Jones, Walter Scott, Freddie Gray talked about Ferguson. It's interesting that whenever they mention these names, they never mention any women's names. No, it's as if when we say Black Lives Matter, we're only saying that Black men's lives matter. And what I find really impressive about the Black Lives Matter organization and their website is that they're very specific about naming Black women and Black differently abled people, and Black lesbians, and Black trans people, and Black, it goes on and on. And then, of course, that would mean that all lives matter. The film provides a good critique of mandatory minimums. It's a good critique of the way the war on drugs helped to drive policies that led to over-incarceration. And I think it encourages us to look at structural racism. And I was also, I mean, I'm usually criticizing Obama, but I was impressed by the fact that effectively he called for banning the box. And are you familiar with the Ban the Box campaign? The box on any job application and on many college admission applications that ask whether you have ever been convicted of a crime. And I'm not sure whether the admissions application here at Keene State, there is such a box. Well, that means there should also be a Ban the Box movement here on this planet. And so this documentary, I think, reflects a new move, a new moment with respect to an issue that many of us radical scholars, activists, have been focusing on for many years. What is good is that a new vocabulary, which is the old vocabulary of the abolitionist movement, the carceral state, prison nation, mass incarceration, addiction to incarceration, is normalized in that film. And this is all good. This is all very good. But, and this is my question, and this is the question, I suppose, that has a great deal to do with the meaning of freedom. What if the system cannot be fixed? What if the system cannot be fixed? What happens if we recognize that the history of the prison is precisely